واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا.
وصلي اللهم عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهديه واتبع سنته واقتفى أثره بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، وقد روى البخاري عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال: لا هجرة بعد الفتح ولكن جهاد ونية. في رواية البخاري قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: There is no migration after conquering Mecca. But you still have the reward of that. You want to do two things. Jihad, you're not allowed to talk about jihad anymore. And niyyah, good intention. So on this very hadith and similar narrations like that hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is addressing the importance of hijra, the reward of hijra, migration. And it is well known, it was an obligation on the believers to do hijra from Mecca to Medina. But after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conquered Mecca, such obligation has no place anymore. So this is why he confirmed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this very narration, that there is no hijra anymore after conquering Mecca. That's it. Islam has been settled, the da'wah has been spread, and so on. But for those who didn't get the reward of hijra, he said you can still catch up. You can still have that reward. In two things, jihad and waniyah. Number one is jihad in the wider meaning, not only in the battlefield. In the wider meaning will be included as well, like struggling against your whims and desires and improving your own character and delivering goodness and the rest of it. Fighting for justice, fighting oppression and unfairness, this is jihad as well. I know some people, the hardcore people, don't like what I'm saying, but I don't care. The Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned the wider meaning of jihad as well. In the narration which Imam al-Bayhaqi narrated, that al-mujahid man jahada nafsa, the mujahid, the definition of mujahid, is the one who is striving against his own whims and desires. So this is the prophetic definition of the mujahid, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I'm addressing the issue of migration and hijra because we started the new hijri year. And this is something very common. People always connect hijra with this very month. But there's no connection, to be honest with you, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made his hijra in Rabi'ul Awwal. Rabi'ul Awwal, he arrived to Medina, 12th, more likely 12th of Rabi'ul Awwal, which is far from Muharram. So we are Muharram now, then Safar, Rabi'ul Awwal, you know, it's far. It's not that in that month. But nevertheless, just very quickly, I'm not going to go through the history of hijra. After the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I just wanted to do some reflections on the hijra. After he exhausted his efforts, he tried all the means, and he has done his best, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to deliver the message in Mecca 13 years after the revelation. He reached to a dead end. People are not, especially Quraysh, I mean, are not willing to listen. And not only this, they are not even willing to tolerate him to be amongst them anymore. They decided to assassinate him. which is not far from what we have these days. The same. You don't like somebody, you go and kill him. You don't like what he's saying, you go and shut him down. Be it a channel, be it a newspaper, be it a person, you name it. So it's not far from Jahiliyyah what we do these days. It's still Jahiliyyah in new terms. So they decided to kill the Prophet. And then, you know the rest of the story. His uncle protected him. They went to the siege Sheikh Abi Talib for 3 years. And he lost his wife at that time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And many things happened. 3 years under siege. And then the Isra wal Mi'raj happened. And then the obligation of Salah happened. And then he received the command from Allah to do Hijra. But even before that, he was still delivering the message to those who come to Mecca to do Hajj or Umrah, until 6 people from Yathrib accepted his message, and they went back. They brought next year with them 12 men. And they've done what we call in Sira Bay'atul Aqaba al-Ula, the first Aqaba, or the first treaty with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they have done bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The year after, they brought with them 75, amongst them two. And the narrators of the seerah in particular, they highlight two women. And I want to highlight this as well. Why that? Because women were in every decision before and after Islam. But I don't know, sometimes some people, when they accept Islam or when they practice Islam, they are a bit against women to a certain extent. She was in the core of the second aqab, second bay'ah of the Prophet. And then he decided, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after he took his bay'ah from them, they decided to protect her, to host her, to fight with her. He decided to go after he received the permission from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know the rest of the story. But my reflection on the story of Hijra, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he did not give up. He tried his best, not one, not two, not 3 years, 13 years, trying to penetrate the stubbornness of Quraysh. No way. He did not give up. He tried outside Mecca as well. We know the story of Al-Talib, the stone him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was even so injured, alayhi salatu wa sallam. He never gave up. He tried and tried. But he himself, he mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it never crossed my mind that Yathrib, which is Medina later, will be the place. It didn't cross his mind that Yathrib will be the place. But it's Allah's destiny. He gives you relief from places which you never expect. So Yathrib was the place, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he has some relatives in Yathrib, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he tried his best. He delivered the message. He never gave up. Ongoing, ongoing, ongoing hard work. He didn't say, I'm supported by revelation and things will be done my way. No. He was starving under siege in Mecca. 3 years until the companions say, we have eaten the leaves of the trees. The leaves of the trees under siege. And Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who is supported by revelation, by Jibreel, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, He was suffering. He was hungry. He was tired. He was exhausted. Has he given up?
No, never. He never
gave up, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the inspiration from Hijra. He dealt with the means. He never relied on the means, but he dealt with it. It needs to be disguised. During Hijra, he went to that very cave where it's very easy to be seen. But this is the only mean he can see around him. He can deal with. He dealt with it. And then, do not worry. Inna Allah ma'ana. Allah is with us. Allah has protected him. But this protection for every one of us is conditional. We have to deal with the means and leave the rest to Allah. But don't sit down and say, yes, Ya Allah, facilitate this, facilitate that, and we do nothing. He was always on the top of everything he's doing. If his companions were putting one stone on their stomach because of hunger, he used to put two. Again, dealing with the means, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the story of Hijra, the lessons which we can get from plenty. Don't give up, number one. Deal with the means, number two. Try your best, number three. And before all of this, rely on Allah. Have trust in Allah. Have tawakkul on Allah. Although we don't have Hijra anymore, but we still can apply Hijra, which is not moving from place to another, but moving from one action to another. And he has been asked about, in another occasion, about who is al-muhajir, who is the migrant, Ya Rasulullah. He said, man hajara ma naha Allahu anhu, the one who forsakes what Allah has prohibited. This is al-muhajir. We can all be that muhajir. We can all be amongst them. The moment we forsake, we leave behind, we leave aside what Allah has prohibited. And this is an ongoing hijrah, if you want. If the hijrah has stopped after conquering Mecca, we still have an ongoing hijrah every day. When you take the bus, when you take the train, when you drive, when you deal with difficulties, you can stay that person who is migrant, muhajir. Leaving what displeases Allah and do what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah. And we can talk for tomorrow. We cannot give Hijra what it deserves from reflections. But these are just some reflections on the meaning of Hijra and the occasion of Hijra. Although, as I repeated again, Hijra wasn't in Muharram, but Umar decided with the companions that they would start the new calendar from Muharram because it's the beginning of the year. And they decided we will do it from Hijra after they have plenty of options, three options. From his death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is one option. Or from his migration, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or after revelation. And some scholars added more than these options, but nevertheless, these are the main options. So Umar decided with the rest of the companions that Hijra was the new beginning, new opening for us. So let's start our history, the Islamic history, the Islamic calendar from Hijra. And it happened to be that Muharram was the beginning of the year. So he said, we start with Muharram. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to apply Hijra in our life and to be that person who is always doing what pleases Allah and
اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله اكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.